C'est extraordinaire, c'est quoi? On est en train de travailler ensemble. Donc voilà, j'ai attendu qu'il ait 60 ans pour qu'on puisse commencer à travailler ensemble et c'est très sympa. Ok, so I changed a little bit what I because I did not have really time to make the slides, so I changed a bit my mind and so I will present something I did 2 years ago on MCMC, Langevin diffusion. So it's connected somehow with a talk by Jacques. And also control variants for MCMC. So it's a joint work with Alain Durmus, who is now working at INS Paris-Saclay, former PhD student of mine, and several co-authors, so Sean Mine. So the work started a long time ago with Sean Mine, and so not exactly for doing variance reduction, but for stochastic controls to solve stochastic control problems, but it's basically the same problem. So most of this work has been completed by two PhD students, which are Sergei Samsonov, who is working at Moscow, so it's in HD lab in HSE, so and Nicolas Bros, who is now working in Thales, but was working with me until last 2 years ago. Okay. Okay, so next slide. So I switch a slide, sorry. Okay. So that will be the outline of my talk. So I start with a very small introduction. So I will explain then what are control variants for Markov chains. Then I will explain what are control variants for Langevin diffusion. And then I will see that in for some Markov chain, at least, then you can use control variants which have been defined for Langevin diffusion. And there are good control variants for Markov chain, for certain types of Markov chain. And then I will conclude with some numerical experiments. Okay, so what are my objectives? So, of course, the objective of what I do from about 30 years is to sample distribution for which are very complex and which are known in general up to normalizing factors. And for which, of course, sampling directly from this distribution is not an option because this distribution you are in very large dimension and then it's not easy, they're not easy to sample. So there are many applications. So my favorite application are of course in Bayesian statistics and machine learning, but there are other applications like in molecular simulation. I'm not an expert, so but it's of course a domain of application of this type of ideas, Turing theory, networks, and also control theory. And more recently, there are a lot of things which are being developing right now in reinforcement learning. For example, Thompson sampling use a lot of MCMC technology and there are many things in reinforcement learning, which is very hot topic today, in which this type of idea can be used. And when you have a distribution which is known up to MTPK factors, there are not so many options. So there are basically there are several options. You can typically do something linked with important sampling, but in that dimension, it's not. Sometimes it's not very appropriate. So there are some improvement of that, which are like sequential Monte Carlo techniques, which have been developed by Pierre Desmoral and Arnaud Doucet a lot. But MCMC, which is Markov chain Monte Carlo, which introduced a long time ago, is still is a technique of reference. So what I will say today is more or less, it's as I say, it's control variance for Markov chain, but most of the application I know are related to develop control variance for MCMC simulation. Okay, so I will start by explaining what can be an MCMC simulation for what is MCMC simulation for Markov chain. So I will what are the techniques? So what you know is that you are willing to sample pi of f. So pi is very complex distribution. So what you do typically in a MCMC technology is that you are designing a Markov kernel, which is denoted by R. And then this Markov kernel implicitly is easy to sample from. So and what you do, you have given this Markov kernel, so you and given an initial distribution, of course, you sample a Markov chain Xk, and then you compute averages, sample averages. So sometimes you just discard the first initial point. So there is something called burn-in. But I did not, so I start from zero there. So of course there are so many adaptations that can be done. So okay, that's a basic idea. So now you are willing to understand a little bit more what are the fluctuations of this quantity. So and to understand a little bit more the fluctuation of this quantity, there is a tool which is very, it's not very classical, in fact. So it's to look at what is called the Poisson equation. So what is a Poisson equation? So Poisson equation is simply this equation. So it's a function f at d. So a solution of a Poisson equation is a function f at d, which is a solution of this problem. So f at d minus r. So r is the Markov kernel. F at d should be equal to f tilde. F tilde is f minus pi of f. Of course, I assume that everything is well defined there. And so assuming that you have, so if the kernel is say sensible, but it, in fact Poisson equation exists under very, so you simply need this, in fact, so you simply, so even it's less than that, but so basically if you have this, of course you have a solution to the Poisson equation, and then now when you have this solution of Poisson equation, you simply substitute f tilde by this difference by f at d minus r f at d. So you just substitute that in this equation, you obtain this, okay? So that's not very difficult. And what you do typically, there is something very simple there. What you do is that you simply decompose this sum in two sums. So you just take r xk becomes xk minus one, okay? And because you have changes xk to xk minus one, you have to add and subtract the boundary terms. And then you obtain a decomposition like that. So it seems very, very simple. So it not seems so very sophisticated, but what you see there is something which is interesting because the quantity which appears there is simply a martingale increment. So which means that all these quantities are martingale. So basically, so because all these quantities are martingales, what you can do is that you will do typically, you will apply if you are in the limit a martingale central limit theorem. So under very, very general condition, it's not a way to obtain the most, if you are willing to look at under which condition a Markov chain will have a CLT, it's not you should be a little bit more careful than that. So it will not provide you with the most general way to prove a CLT, but it's a very easy way to prove a CLT for a Markov chain. So you do the central limit theorem. So you typically take the square of this martingale, also assuming that this square exists. You just compute this quantity because it's martingale increment. It's this square is the sum of the square. So you take the expectation, and provided that the Markov chain is ergodic, this expectation converges depending upon the what you know about the Markov kernel. It converges more or less for most of the initial condition to some quantity which is typically the asymptotic variance in the CLT. So this quantity has an expression which is interesting to understand. It's written like that. So it's really expectation under pi, so under the stationary distribution of the increment of this martingale increment. So it's given by that. So you are in the stationary distribution. You take the Markov increment between one and zero, and if you simply expand this, quantity, you obtain a difference of the square of the Poisson solution minus the expectation under pi of R, so the kernel applied to the Poisson solution. If you develop this this difference, you simply and then you simply obtain this very simple expression. So which gives the asymptotic variance in the CLT of a Markov chain, which is pi f tilde f at d, so which is a Poisson solution minus a term which is minus pi of f tilde square. Okay, so that gives you a very simple expression. There are many different ways to obtain this condition, and of course we know the condition, more or less the minimal condition under which you have a CLT, but it's not the problem of today. Okay, starting from this, of course, when you look at this quantity, it provides you with some idea to control variance. So control variance are very popular in Monte Carlo techniques. So what is a control variance? So it's control variance is, I did control variance with Benjamin a long time ago, 15 years ago. So control variance are simply functions which are which could be whose expectation under pi should be equal to zero, and of course you expect that the asymptotic variance of f plus h should be, of course, but that's objective is to find a function for which you know that pi of h is equal to zero, and if you add this function to f, then the asymptotic variance should be lower and sometimes significantly lower than the variance of f. Okay. So De Laportas and Contoyanis around was 10 years ago, more or less, because the paper was published in 2012, but I think the idea was introduced earlier. So it's an idea which has been used a lot in queuing theory, by the way, to stochastic networks. It's a technique which has been used a lot. So one idea is to construct control variates of this form. So it's like H equal R minus IDG. So you choose a function G, you look at R minus IDG. So of course, pi of H is equal to zero because pi is a stationary distribution of R. So you have pi R which is equal to pi. So it's a universal way to construct control variates. And starting from this, of course, it's easy to understand. So if you look at this expression, if you want to compute the asymptotic, if you want to compute the asymptotic variance in the CLT, you need to compute the Poisson equation. So in fact, there is a very easy way because the structure provides you with a very easy way to construct the Poisson solution of F plus H. Okay, so if you take H like that, so the Poisson solution for F plus H is equal to F at D minus G. So it's easy because you have ID minus R F at D is equal to F tilde. And by definition, of course, ID minus R minus G is equal to R minus IDG. So in fact, it's easy. See, if you take a control variate of the form H equal R minus IDG, the Poisson solution associated with F plus H is completely explicit. It's the Poisson solution of F minus G. Okay, so if you plug that now in the expression for the asymptotic variance in the CLT, it was the pointer. Okay, so what you obtain is that it's funny. I don't see the pointer anymore. Okay. It's better. So what you get this quantity, okay? And now you have to minimize with respect to G this quantity. So you have this quantity, so it's okay. So it gives you a kind of optimization problem to solve. So it's not doesn't seem to be very a nice one because you need to compute the Poisson equation and computing the Poisson equation is difficult. So you want to get rid of that. So the computational bottleneck in the previous expression is to compute the Poisson equation. So as I say, it's intractable, so you don't want to do this, but this computation can be bypassed provided that you take R to be reversible with respect to pi. That's the idea of Kontoyanis. There are other techniques which can be used in particular in control in queuing system, because in queuing systems there are different techniques which can be used. But the idea Laportas in Kontoyanis is to use this class of control variates. But then you use on the top of that the fact that the Markov kernel R is reversible with respect to pi. And if you look now at this expression, you simply expand. So you expand this expression, so it's very algebraic. So you have a lot of terms which are not very interesting. This one does not depend upon G, so you don't care because you are willing to solve the optimization problem. This one doesn't depend upon G, but with F tilde, so this one is perfectly nice. And this one also is perfectly nice. The only term which is not nice is this one, okay, which is R minus IDG F tilde D. Okay, but what you know, of course, now is that if R is reversible, okay, R is reversible, so it's self-adjoint with respect to the scalar product under the stationary distribution pi, so which means that you have pi of R minus IDG F at D, which is equal to minus pi G F tilde. So it's the reversibility of the kernel, which implies, in fact, that the R minus R as an operator in L2 pi is self-adjoint with respect to L2 pi. So you just apply R minus ID to F at D, and by definition is F tilde. So the good news now is that you can minimize asymptotic variance without having to compute F and D, and the bad news that it still requires to compute RG. Okay, so that's a limitation. So you need to require to compute RG. So it's easy in some cases. In particular, it's easy when you are using a Gibbs sampler. So for example, if it for some Gibbs sampler, in case of when you have, for example, large Gaussian measure and things like that. So there are many applications which have been developed by De La Portas and Kontoyanis. But in general case, in many cases, in fact, computing RG is not easy. So we did basically the same trick as this one with Sean Mine to solve optimal control problem before. Okay, so now look at the problem of computed control variate for diffusion. So So it's basically the same idea. So you start with an SDE, or say what I will assume here is that delta U of X is Lipschitz with a coefficient, Lipschitz coefficient, which is equal to L. So U is super. What I assume is that U is very well behaved. So it's C infinity has at most polynomial growth, and all these derivatives at last polynomial growth. So it's a nice one. So not a very complicated one. So so what I will assume. So of course the Langevin diffusion has a unique strong solution, which is YTX for any starting position X. And so you might define a semi-group, which is PT. So there are very classical properties. Pi is invariant with respect to PT. And PT is strongly continuous contraction semi-group in L2 pi. So it's that's a very classical problem. So of course, you might define for any G in L2 pi. So basically, you might define you might find a function F, which is such that LF is equal to G. At least when F belongs to a subset of the generator, so it's a domain which is a subset of L2 pi for which such limits exist. So it's a generator in L2 pi. What you can prove properties. So assuming that you have nice properties, so I will not spend much time on that. So U is super smart. Grad of U is Lipschitz. Pi has exponential moments. What you can prove is that. With respect to that, any function phi, which is C2 and which has polynomial growth in the tails, belong to L2 pi, because pi has exponential moment, belong to the domain of this L2 pi generator and satisfies this equation. So L phi is equal to minus grad U F grad phi plus Laplacian of phi. So not a big surprise for Langevin diffusion. And also that for any function H1 and H2, you have this type of self-adjointness condition in this time in L2 pi. Okay, so it's perfectly fine. So you simply have to be a little bit more careful than the discrete time, because it's not true for any function, but for function which defined on a dense subset of L2 pi. Not a big deal. Okay, so if you are on the top of that, if you assume that PT, the semigroup, is V uniformly geometrically ergodic, okay. So what it means? It means basically that when you look at the delta x pt minus pi, so in V norm, so we converge as CV rho t V of x. Okay, so that happens under conditions which are well known. So there are many conditions upon which, of course, it's linked with tail condition of the potential, but it's not. It has been very well studied, in particular. I think by Roberts in the beginning of the 90s. So Garrett Roberts did a lot in this direction. So to have a condition under which this condition exists. So you have a V-norm contraction. If you have V-norm contraction, then you can also find a Poisson solution. So you can define Poisson solution for this equation, which are given by this. Okay. And then you have you may show that the Poisson equation is unique to up to an additive constant, not a big surprise. That and for any function f which is in LV 1/2, well, so which has a growth which is controlled by the function v, so you can prove that this function also belongs to LV 1/2 and is a solution of this equation. Okay, so it's perfectly nice. So you have a tractable set of functions for which you know that you can solve this problem, which is good. Okay, starting from this, you do exactly the same that in discrete case. So what you can do is that you can do exactly what I did before. So basically, it's the same type of technique. So you substitute F tilde by the solution of the Poisson equation, and you work out a little bit the equation. And you obtain, in such a case, you obtain this expression for the variance, and also you obtain a CLT under the same condition with this time, continuous time, central limit theorems for martingales. And so you have an expression for the asymptotic variance in this CLT, which is given by this. So it's almost the same that in discrete case. It's not exactly the same, because in discrete case, you have minus pi of phi tilde squared. So it's simply two times in continuous game, it's two times pi of the Poisson equation, the Poisson solution, but this time the continuous time Poisson equation times F tilde. Okay, so very closely related. So it's simply one term which is different from the discrete case. Okay, so same idea. So is it possible to construct control variates? So there is a key remark. So it's basically the same remarks than in discrete case. So there is a kind of universal way to construct a control variate, which is to apply, you take a function G belonging to the domain of the generator L. And what you can prove is that pi of L of G is equal to zero. Okay, so nice. So you have a super large family of functions which have zero mean under zero. So these are called in general in statistics Stein control variate, because it's linked, it might be seen to be related with what is called to the Stein method in statistics. So it's called Stein control variate, but it's simply you take G and you apply the generator. So applying the generator to G, it's pi of L of G is equal to zero. So it's a control variate. So what you will do is that you do basically the same. So I take the function F, I add L of G. So it's a well-defined control variate, and just I have to optimize these problems. I will try to find the minimum under G of this expression. Okay, so I can take, for example, linear control functions. So in that case, you develop you take a dictionary of function psi and you compute a linear combination. So typically you use a very large dictionary, so you may have to add some penalty terms. So we did some statistics. If you look at what I did, you can do some statistics. So it can be seen as a kind of non-parametric regression problem. So you add a lasso type penalty and things like that. But the thing which is very right now very fashionable, so we say, it's to use non-linear control function like. And one candidates are linked with neural control functions where you use deep learning. So it's basically the same idea, but you use a deep network to construct a control variant. Okay. Nice. Okay. So now you have to solve this problem. So to find the minimizer, it's that you have to solve this minimization problem. So it's basically written like that. The key remark there is that if you are willing to compute the Poisson solution of F tilde minus LG, so it's very simple, exactly like in discrete case. It's simple because it's simply L of F hat minus G. So it's nice. So basically you get this expression for the control variates. So it's given by this. So it's a scalar product of F hat minus G, F tilde plus LG. You repeat the argument before. Okay, so I repeat the argument. Okay, four terms, when I expand, only one term which is annoying, which is this one. But of course, you will add what you will use there. You will use the fact there that L is self-adjoint on DL. So it's on the domain of the generator. So because L is self-adjoint in the domain of generator, it's a pi of F hat L of G, the same thing that pi of L F hat and G, okay? And L F hat is equal to F tilde. So it's you have a term which is minus four pi of G F tilde. Okay. And then for the last term, in fact, it's more convenient to remark that pi of G L G is equal to pi to the square of the gradient of G, which is valid provided that G belongs to C infinity poly. Okay. So now to solve the optimization problem, so you have to solve, in fact, a control problem, which is you have to find the function G. And so you don't have to evaluate F at the Poisson equation to solve this problem. Okay. But the good news now is that this problem is in general easy to solve. So it's very easy to obtain a good control variate. So typically, if you are just to do something simple. So what you do is that you take a function which are regular. So you have to compute a pi of grad of psi I minus psi g. So in general, it's not very difficult. So you estimate it on a preliminary run. So you can compute this function, you compute the gradient, and then you estimate, you do a pre-run. So this is where you do some statistics, but because you are probabilist, you are not very interested by, okay, there is some excess risk because I need to estimate this quantity. So if the number of parameter theta becomes large, you have to be a little bit careful. So perhaps you will have to use some kind of rich regression or lasso penalty. So this is the case when you are doing linear problems. If you are doing non-linear problems, then you have to control the complexity of the class of functions. So but okay, there is nothing very fancy there. So I don't, I just don't speak about that. But it gives you, if you assuming that you can compute the function h, it's easy to compute a function g. So which means that the good news is that in fact, because computing L of g is in generally easy, whereas computing RG is not easy. So in fact, it's easier to construct good control variates for Langevin diffusion than to construct good control variates for general Markov chaos. Okay, so the problem that I will, the last problem I will try to answer is, okay, so it's fine. So I understood that I have a way to construct good control variates for Langevin diffusion. And what I am willing to do is I'm willing to say, okay, whether this technique can be used to construct control variates for discrete chain, Markov chain. In fact, it's yes in certain case. And why it's yes in certain case, because this is the second result I will present today, is that in certain case, it is yes, the answer is yes, because it's easy, in fact, to see that for some Markov chain, in fact, you can show that in some limits, and I will explain the type of limits, that the asymptotic variance of the Markov chain is given, in fact, by the asymptotic variance of the Langevin diffusion. So it's not true for all Markov chains, but as I will see, it is as less true for three Markov chains, which are very interesting, and which are the following one. Remember, so, okay, sorry. So remember, so, okay, back to MCMC now. So in MCMC, what I am willing to do, I am willing to sample a distribution. Now I assume that the distribution I'm willing to sample is given by this pi of x. So it's E minus UX, which is a potential. So it was a potential used in Langevin. Z is a normalizing constant, okay, which is a known, of course. And what I assume in the sequel is that this potential is gradient Lipschitz, so it's a Lipschitz constant which is equal to L. So there are MCMC samplers, so as presented in the previous talk. So and there are, I will present three samplers. So I will use three samplers. So there, the random walk metropolis, which has already been presented before. What is something which is called EULA? So EULA is simply the plane discretization of the Langevin diffusion. Okay. And MALA, which is the discretization of the Langevin diffusion, on the top of which you have added a metropolis elastic step in order to correct for the bias in the discretization. And then, of course, you have other techniques. But for these other techniques, of course, in fact, the same type of FAMD could have been used, but it has not been yet done. So, of course, it would be interesting to do, but it has not been yet done. So this, it will not be a Langevin diffusion in that case. It will be something else. But I think the same idea can be used. But and in particular, I think the same idea can be used for Hamiltonian Monte Carlo. So it would be interesting to look, because Hamiltonian Monte Carlo is a technique of reference now in MCMC. It's no longer a MALA. And I think for HMC, you can use the same technique, because you can construct control variates for continuous time Hamiltonian Monte Carlo dynamics, basically in the same way, because you have a kind of reversibility, but it's not a diffusion in that case. So it's more, it's a little bit more complicated. It's another type of Markov semigroups, not at all the same structure, but the same idea can be used, but I do not have time to develop all the details. Okay, so just to switch back to Langevin. So as I said, so the first technique is to, the easiest technique is to use a discretization of the Langevin, so Euler discretization, the simplest one. So it's explicit schemes with a step size gamma, okay? So of course, they define the Markov chain. So of course, the Markov kernel has nice property. It doesn't converge under, it doesn't converge to pi, so it converges, there is some bias. So it's so limiting, so you can prove that it has a limiting distribution. And it is well behaved in some sense, but the limiting distribution is pi gamma. So and, you can more or less quantify how far pi gamma is with pi, depending upon the step size that you've used, gamma. But there is a technique which is to which has been introduced by Garrett Roberts in 1996, in fact, with Richard Tweedy, which is called MALA. So MALA stands for Metropolis Adjusted Langevin Algorithm. So what you do typically is that you use the discretized Langevin diffusion as a proposal distribution in a metropolis Hastings method. So when you use an additional step, so when you do some kind of acceptance rejection, and so it's easy to obtain acceptance rejection. So you simply draw a coin You propose yk plus 1 according to a diffusion. You draw a coin and you accept or reject the proposal with some probability, which is given there. And what you can prove is that this metropolitan kernel is reversible with respect to pi. And what you can prove also is that R gamma is also V geometrically ergodic. But of course, it's in general more difficult to prove ergodicity of Mala than for Eula. In fact, we have a proof of that now, because so it's funny that there was essentially no real proof of V geometrically ergodicity of Mala. So if you are interested, we discuss this. Okay, and so what I will prove, in fact, is I will prove that if I take Eula, Mala, and of course the famous RWBM, so all this kernel depends upon some parameter gamma. So gamma in the Eula case is the step size that you use in the Euler discretization. In Mala, it's the same. It's the gamma that you use in the Euler discretization of the proposal. In random work, of course, it's a variance of the diffusion of the increment distribution that you use in the random work, and you do accept reject. Okay, so you define every time you define in fact a family of Markov kernel which are indexed by some parameter gamma. And what we will prove basically is that when gamma goes to zero, in fact, you have in some very strong sense, in fact, a limit to continuous time, to the continuous time diffusion. Okay, so what are the assumptions that we need? So we need first that R gamma converges to have a kind of expansion in terms of gamma, like R gamma F should be F plus gamma times the Langevin LF, the generator of the diffusion, plus, in fact, a reminder term, which is gamma alpha to and E gamma of F, which is a kind of operator, it's a differential operator on F with some properties. And of course, you need to control, so there is, of course, some technical details which are hidden there. So, of course, you need to control a bit how this operator belongs. So, the second property which is interesting in the theory. And in fact, that's the most difficult part, in fact, of our theory, is to prove that it is true. So what you have to prove is that uniformly with respect to gamma, so which means for all gamma in some interval zero gamma bar, so first that R gamma should have a unique invariant distribution, of course, depending upon pi gamma, because as I said, for Eula, it will not always, so for if you are reversible with respect to, if R gamma is reversible with respect to pi gamma will be equal to pi, but for Eula, it's not the case. So which means that you need to prove that for all this gamma, you have a pi gamma. And the thing which is the most difficult to prove, in fact, is that you are uniformly ergodic, but in a very strong sense, in the sense that the thing which is important there is that you have either rho of n gamma. So it's the same rho, okay, it's of n gamma. So which means n gamma, typically, if you think about what is Eula or what is Mala, n gamma, in fact, is if you use gamma, and then you need to... So n gamma is back is a kind of physical time. So because e gamma goes to zero, of course, it's not so difficult to prove that you are V geometrically ergodic, but it's difficult to prove that, in fact, it's V geometric with a mixing time, of course, the mixing coefficient, which is n gamma. Okay, so starting from this condition, so you have basically two technical conditions. Okay, these two conditions, H4. What you can prove first that you have a control of pi gamma, okay? So pi gamma in that case will be something like gamma to the power alpha minus one, okay? Provided, of course, that pi gamma is not equal to pi. So you retrieve, in fact, in the case where you have, for example, for Eula, you retrieve that you have for U, because U is very nice, so you have alpha is equal to 2 in Eula, provided that U is sufficiently smooth, so which means that you have pi gamma F minus pi is equal to gamma, in fact, for Eula. And then what you can prove also is the following result. What you can prove also is the following result you have an explicit control of the discrepancy between the variance of the Markov chain, okay, with proper normalization, of course. So n gamma is very important there because it's a physical time. So n gamma is a physical time there. And you can control explicitly, in fact, how far the variance of your Markov chain, okay, recentered by pi gamma, is from the stationary distribution sigma infinity of F, which is, in fact, which is a variance of the Langevin diffusion. So it's, in fact, you have a kind of, and okay, that's more or less technical to prove that you can, of course, relate the variance of the diffusion with the variance of the Markov chain, but with respect to gamma, and the thing, it's not asymptotic in the sense that it's not an asymptotic result, it's really a finite time bounds, where so you have an explicit dependence, explicit constant, everything is explicit. And the thing which is interesting is that you have one term, which is n gamma to the power 1/2. It's not a big surprise, by the way, because n gamma, as I said, is a physical time. So if you look at the Euler case, it's a time spent for the diffusion. So of course, you need to n gamma to be large to go to the stationary regime. And then you have a gamma alpha minus 1, and it's a minimum with 1, of course. And so which means that you have more or less the best that you can achieve, in fact, is gamma. So it would be gamma in Euler and Mala, and it would be a square root of gamma in the case of RWM. Okay? So just to conclude, so the proof, okay, you are a bit tied for the proof. It's funny, the proofs are funny, it's more or less funny. It's not super difficult, but it's a bit, you know, a lot of time to control, but it's... So I will see like one-dimensional example. So it's funny because in one-dimensional example, it's interesting to understand how it works. So you take a mixture of two Gaussians, so one with mean minus one, the other one with mean one. So you take the variance 1/2, and you take any test function, or this one, so it's not very interesting. So what you can do is, of course, you are in dimension one, so you can integrate explicitly, you can compute the Poisson equation. So it's funny because the Poisson equation is very wild already. So it's 1/π(x). So if you have a two Gaussian, which means that it really blows up at zero, which is not a big surprise. So it means the Poisson solution it blows up at zero. So and then what you do control variance. So as control variance, I use Markov kernel. So it's like I use radial kernels. Okay, it's okay. Okay, so. And what I do here, okay, sorry. So I compute this. So you can control functional. So there are two ways to do control functional. The first way is the way that I described here, and the way which is using the technique, which is really the reference technique in the field, which is called zero variance estimator, which has been proposed a long time ago in statistical physics by Asaraf, and which had been popularized in Bayesian statistics by Antonietta Mira, and so 15 years ago, but it's really a work by people in the molecular dynamics in Toulouse, so Michel Asaraf, so which is called the zero variance estimator, which is defined. So it also uses Stein control variance, which also uses linear control functionals, but the way it constructs the control functional, it's not the same, so it's not minimizing the same quantity, so it's related, but it's not exactly the same. And so what we can prove, so that you construct, you more or less approximate with this kernel, you approximate the solution, so that's the solution of, so if you look this on this panel, so the panel on the left panel is a Poisson equation. So you approximate basically the Poisson equation for which you have the zero variance. And you can see on this plot there that the condition that we have, it means that we have a much less correlation than all the techniques. So we kill more or less the correlation. So it works well. And also it works well on, it's extremely good in that case. So you reduce the variance by more than a factor of 10. And we have also other examples, so like in Bayesian logistic probit regression, we have a lot of examples. So we have a preprint, so because the paper has been there for quite for at least 2 years. So there are much more examples. In for example, if you're interested, we have system of ODEs. We have so we do Bayesian statistic on system of ODEs. We have we do Bayesian analysis with diffusion, and it works very well in all these cases. Okay, thanks a lot for your attention, and I'm ready to answer some questions.